me the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, and now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Your open arms and the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? The mighty King of
cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. Body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone.
In Luke 24 it says, but very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, Two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen from the dead."
Then on the third, at break of dawn, the sun of heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. Can you say this along with me? He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. He is risen.
He is risen.
One more time. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. Hallelujah. 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 We are so excited to be here today to celebrate our risen King. So we thank you for coming. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for being online with us. It is a good day to celebrate all that our God has done. As we get started in worship today, I'm going to just ask you, if you have a seat in between you and someone else, if you could just scoot toward the middle. We're trying to welcome as many people as we can today. So go ahead, scoot in, make sure that you leave any empty seats on the end of your rows. And why don't you go ahead and turn to someone next to you, greet them, let them know that Jesus Christ is risen.
those walls that we called sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we called Psalm 8, it says, he has ordained praise from the mouths of children and infants to silence the enemy. So we're going to join our kids today in praise. Amen? I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
with me. You rose, and you rose from death to victory, and you reign in life, O Majesty. Your name be high and lifted up, Jesus, Jesus, alive in us. You rose from death to victory, and you reign in life. Jesus, we celebrate you in this place this morning. You are Lord. Your name is above every other name. You came, you gave your life for us, and now we have life because of that. So we bless you and we honor you. We worship you today from thankful hearts, and we love that you are here with us. Holy Spirit, come and have your way in our presence today, we pray. All of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You can have a seat. I'm going to invite our hospitality team to come forward, and we're going to continue to worship with our offering this morning. So as they come, let me pray again. Father, thank you for your many blessings in our lives, for your goodness to us. We ask, God, that you would take these gifts and many others that have been given, and that you would use them for good things, that people would come to know you as a result of it. May they fund good ministry. We love you and we bless you in your name. Amen. Amen.
Father loved us so, so high. Good morning, everybody, and welcome. You know, and if you're in the chapel, special welcome to you. And we've got a bonus for you in the chapel today. After this service, there are homemade cookies out in the foyer, and I will keep these people here so you get out there first. So it'll be a good day for you at the end. Really will be. Well, you know, somewhere it says, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. And I don't know if there's a better day today than to say that. This is the day. You know what? Already you are so much better than the first service. They look at me like, what did you say? You have to go over it 3 times, but you get it the first time. This is really good. We'll save some cookies for you. It'll be a good day. If you received a letter in the mail and it looked like it was on official letterhead from a law firm, and it said you had a distant relative that died and you didn't even know about this person, and they left you $2 million, please contact us, you'd be skeptical. There's so many scams out there, isn't there? But I bet you'd check it out. Well, I would. The offer is just too good to be true. I mean, you'd check it out at least. You know, maybe you're here today and you're skeptical about the fact that God raised Jesus from the dead. But I want to tell you, the offer is just too good not to check out. It's just too good not to check out. Think about the offer on the table. Life that lasts forever. That's a pretty good offer right there. But a new body to enjoy it, that's even better. And a new earth, this one redone, where there's no bad water, there's no hunger. You could go to Gaza, you could go to Sudan, you could go anywhere on the planet, and everybody would have clean water and good food. No bombs dropping on innocent people, no terrorists, just peace, right living. The offer is just too good not to check out at least. I hope today that you'll at least check out what God has on the table when he says through his son, I'm the resurrection and the life. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. That's the offer. You know, the resurrection of Jesus is recorded in 4 documents, books in the New Testament. The New Testament part of the Bible starts with Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Those are all written by friends of Jesus. And they all have fascinating accounts of that day when God raised Jesus from the dead. John's is interesting. He has this account, we'll look at it a bit later, of Mary, friend of his, who encountered Jesus the Sunday he was raised from the dead. It was quiet. It was personal. It was in a secluded park. Luke, on the other hand, has a very funny, strange story about the resurrection. He says that there were these 2 disciples in Jerusalem from a town just a little ways away called Emmaus. And they were in Jerusalem and they heard the news that Jesus had been raised from the dead, but they didn't check it out. They had dinner reservations in Emmaus and they didn't cancel them. They just went home. That's weird. And then, Matthew's is the best. I love Matthew's. Let me read what Matthew says. Matthew says, there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Think about that. Matthew says the resurrection rocked the world. It rocked the world. A violent earthquake. An angel comes down from heaven. Now when they laid Jesus in the tomb, a massive stone was put across the entrance. And then Pilate said, make it as secure as is humanly possible to secure it. And so they put a seal on it, and they had the best of the Roman guards there. Like, nobody was going to get near that thing. And I was imagining last night, I hope not irreverently, the conversation in heaven. Father says it's time to take the stone away. Gabriel says, who will we send? Somebody says, well, send the new guy. It's just one angel goes, rolls away. One angel, not two, not 10, one angel just rolls away the stone like nothing. And then he sits on it. That's really funny to me. You know, I said to someone between the service, I see so much humor in scripture, but the problem is when I say it's funny and nobody laughs, I feel weird, but I think it was funny. I think he sits on the stone. I can see him saying, any of you guards have a problem with this? You know, it's unusual at least. And it says they shook and became like dead men. You know what I think that means? They played dead. Wouldn't you around somebody like that? These angels are powerful beings. And they rolled a stone away. Nobody believed Jesus was alive because the tomb was empty. They believed Jesus was alive because they saw him. That's why they believed he was alive. They encountered him. Just a fascinating, riveting stories of the resurrection in the New Testament. The resurrection of Jesus Christ literally changed everything. Literally changed everything. And I want to try and show you how it changed everything in two ways. First of all, the event or the fact of the resurrection changed everything. The event or the fact. And just think about that with me for a minute. You know, we celebrate Easter Sunday today, resurrection, but you really need to be careful to hold the 3 days together, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, because the resurrection makes no sense unless the significance and uniqueness of what happened Friday is understood. Jesus went to the cross on Friday, and his words were that he was going there to bear the sin of the world. He thought that he was going as a substitute for you, for me, to pay a debt, a sin debt. All the things that we've done to offend God that we can never make right, Jesus said, I'll go to the cross and I'll do it for you. And Jesus thought he was gonna do that work on our behalf. With his last breath, he said, it is finished. It is finished. He understood that the work was done. But how would we ever know? If God hadn't raised him from the dead, how would we know? When God raised Jesus from the dead, it was God's stamp of approval on who Jesus was and what he did. And we can trust that what Jesus said was true because God raised him from the dead. That was the proof right there. And I think what Jesus would say to you today is, I don't save you by your works. I save you by mine. There's nothing you can do to pay your own debt, but you can trust me and I'll save you. That's who we worship today. And then the Saturday, he was buried. Now you might wonder why that's significant. Why didn't it just say in the Bible, he died on Friday, was raised on Sunday? But if you went to a place in the New Testament, I think it's 1 Corinthians 15, it says this, this is the gospel, the good news we've believed. Jesus died, and then it says was buried and was raised from the dead. Buried is as important as anything because by the term buried, we're to understand finality or he really did die. He really was dead. This was no resuscitation on Sunday morning. This was resurrection. This was nobody that had been in some kind of coma and came to. No, this was somebody that everybody knew was dead and they buried him. And on the third day, God raised him from the dead. And then Sunday, of course, the day of resurrection. I wanted to show you a few things about that Sunday because the events around it are to me, they're riveting. And look at in John 20, verse 1, it says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Graves in the ancient world were gravesites. They were repellent places. Everybody believed back then that that's where demons lived. And for sure, it was the hangout for drug addicts and for criminals and thieves. They hung out there. But Mary risks everything to go there on Sunday morning. She just, and John's clear that it was night. It wasn't day, it was night. And that's a very important term for John. It's almost like he writes a highlighter through it when he says it was night or it was dark is actually the word he uses. It's the night of the end of human hope. That's what it is. Have you ever buried somebody? You ever stood at a graveside? Then you'll feel like Mary. It's the death of a friendship. It's the death of somebody you love. It's the death of happiness. It's the death of dreams. And when that casket gets lowered in the ground, it's like hope is in that casket and gets buried with it. That's where Mary was. That's where a lot of us have been at a graveside. Well, why does she go? Why do we go to gravesides even after the person has been buried? Why do we visit them? To remember? To weep? To reflect? Pray? To lay flowers, maybe? But nobody, absolutely nobody, visits a cemetery because they expect somebody to rise out of it. But on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. I like the rest of the story John writes. He says, Mary, stone had been rolled away. She stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the foot. They asked her, woman, why are you crying? They've taken my Lord away, she said, and I don't know where they've laid him, put him. At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't realize it was Jesus. Woman, he said, why are you crying? Who's it you're looking for? Thinking he was the gardener, she said, sir, if you've carried him away, can you tell me where you've put him, and I'll get him. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher, teacher. Mary didn't, how did he reveal himself to her? He didn't say, it's me. He didn't say, Miss Magdalene. He said, Mary. The way he's always said it, Mary. You know, we live in a world, a culture obsessed with identity. Always trying to find out who or what we are. Cultural narrative goes something like this. Look inside, decide who or what you are, and then you assert it, and you don't care what anybody else thinks. That's our culture, the one we live in. But that's impossible because we're social beings. You're never going to have a secure identity just by looking inside and deciding who or what you are and then asserting it no matter what anybody else says. You get a secure identity if someone you adore adores you. You get a secure identity if somebody you respect respects you. You get a secure identity if somebody you love loves you and affirms you. That's how you get a secure identity. And when Jesus Christ, the greatest person in the universe, says to you, Mary, Dan, Bob, Ruth, I love you personally. I love you expensively. I love you eternally. That's security. That's a secure identity, Mary. I was thinking of a line from one of Annie Dillard's novels, a Pulitzer Prize-winning novelist, and she had a line. She said, I've been my whole life a bell. And I didn't know it until somebody lifted me up and struck me. Maybe better, lifted me up and rang me. My whole life I was a bell, and I didn't even know it until somebody lifted me up and rang me. Your whole life you might be trying to figure out who you are. But when Jesus Christ comes and lifts you up and calls you by name, you know who you are. You're a child of the Most High God. Mary, beautiful, the way he introduced himself to her. Well, what about the other disciples? Where were they at? The men, where were they at? Let's read about the men. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Here's Mary and some other women risking everything. Where were the men? Behind locked doors. There's a whole sermon there. In fact, maybe I'll do that. If we could just keep women in their place. No, they were at the forefront. The men, behind locked doors. Again, I find it humorous. Jesus just walks right in through the wall. Peace. We don't use that word much. We used it in the 70s when everybody was high. Peace and groovy love, you know? Remember that? No, you don't, because you weren't born. But peace, we used to say that. This, so being reinterpreted would be, hey, take it easy. Chill. Hey, relax, fellas. You have to say that when you've walked through a wall and you're in the middle of the room. What's the point? This wasn't a resuscitated body, because resuscitated bodies don't walk through walls. This was a resurrected body. This was Jesus back from the dead with his new body, the first of many to come, including you and me who love him. Peace. Take it easy. Relax. I love that line. Hey, actually, can I park there for a minute? Thank you. Just needed one. One yes. That's all I needed. There are a lot of grown men at Crossroads Church. They would say, I'm a follower of Jesus, but they're still behind locked doors. They're afraid to come out and go public and identify as a follower of Jesus Christ. Women are out front, maybe your wife, maybe others, but you're kind of behind locked doors, and well, I don't want anybody to know I'm a Christian. It's time to come out from behind locked doors. It's time to stand up and declare who you are. I'm a follower of Jesus, and take the lead. Take the lead. You know, there's a man I follow from time to time named James Robison. He has a program on Sunday nights when I go home and depressed because of how things didn't go well with my talk, I'm eating my grilled cheese and tomato soup, and I listened to James Robison. He's 80 years old now, but he was a great evangelist in the day. And he would have great stadium events that would rival Billy Graham's. And he'd call people forward. On one occasion, he said, I was preaching and I called people forward. He said, there was a man coming down the aisle right there. He said, there's a big guy. And he said he was weeping. And he said, but there's something going on behind him, and I couldn't figure out what was going on behind him. There was movement behind him, but I couldn't quite see it. So he said, I moved over to the edge of the platform and I watched, and there was a little boy behind him. And the boy was walking like this. Following in his father's footsteps. Somebody's watching you. Somebody's following in your footsteps. Question, where are your footsteps leading? Can I be real bold? I barely got enough to live on, but you can fire me. There's a lot of kids here that aren't here today. You know where they are? Playing hockey. You know why they're playing hockey? Because that's the priority in the home. I'm going to tell you this, that the Lord is prepared to rescue the generation that we grieve over. He is not gonna let them wreck their lives. He's gonna come in an unstoppable way into our high schools and into our colleges, and he's gonna bring scores, thousands and thousands of young people to Jesus Christ. And the day will come. You can write this down. The day will come when they will not miss church to play hockey. They'll miss hockey to go to church. You know why? Because Jesus will become precious to them. The only reason that our kids are following other gods is because that's more precious to them than Jesus. What will happen if you don't come out from behind locked doors when your kids are filled with the Holy Spirit and say to you, Dad, where should I start reading the Bible? And you won't have a clue what to say. And then they say to you, how come, believing this, we never told anybody? What will you say? Like, this is the day to get ready. But it's not going to last long because God's going to come in great power. And at that point, you want to be ready to lead your family, to lead their friends, because there won't be room enough to put them. Okay, I'll end there. That bit. I just wanted to park there for a minute. Just had to get it off my chest. So how did this change, this event change everything? Well, for Mary, it changed everything. For the disciples, they were overjoyed. And if you read their story, they became tremendous men of prayer and power and unashamed witnesses of Jesus, all because of the event of the resurrection. And the early Christians, it changed them too. Do you know what happened for the early Christians? The Jewish greeting was peace be unto you, or peace be with you. That's what they said when they met in the marketplace, or they met in church or at school. Peace be with you. So we say, how are you? They said, peace be with you. You know what the early Christians did? They changed that. And their greeting was, Christ is risen. Whether it was the marketplace, whether it was school, wherever they met, Christ is risen. Why? Because the resurrection changed everything for them, and it was the basis of their hope and their everything, the fact that Christ is risen. And they would never forget that, and they never let each other forget that. They'd be losing their properties, and their goods would be confiscated because they were Christian, but they'd say, Christ is risen, and they would know that they had better and more lasting possessions in the place where they were going. And if they got their roots too deep in this world, they would say, Christ is risen, and they would remember that this world is not where we're to put our roots down deep. We're to lay up our treasure in heaven. Christ is risen. It changed everything. So that's the event of the resurrection. Now, I'm just going to flip that over to the other side of that coin and say the other way the resurrection changed everything, it was not just the event, but the person of the resurrection. The person of the resurrection. Listen to Jesus in John 11. He says to Mary and Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? You see, this is a stunning statement. Do you see what he's doing? He's saying the resurrection isn't just an event, it's a person. The resurrection isn't just a story. It isn't just a doctrine. The resurrection is a person whose name is Jesus Christ. I am the resurrection and life. Now, let me give you a little bit of the backstory behind the statement. He's at a graveside. And Mary and Martha, their brother Lazarus has died. And Jesus doesn't get there in time because they thought he might heal him. But he doesn't get there and Lazarus dies. And both Martha and Mary say, where were you? Or if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. Where were you? You ever said that? God, where were you when this happened to me? Where were you? They're heartbroken. And then Jesus says, you know, your brother will rise at the last day. And they say, yeah, we know at the end he's going to rise. Then Jesus says, hey, wait a minute. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the one. In other words, he's saying to them, you're focused on way far off. You know, here's the thing, and it's not a bad thing. It's true, and it's part of our hope, and I'll talk about it in a minute. But sometimes when we lay somebody to rest, all we can think about is the future, that one day we'll see them again, that one day we'll be reunited. And yet Jesus says to Mary and Martha, let me pull the future into the present for you. Let me tell you that right now in the present, there's life. I am the resurrection of life. It's like he pulls the future into the present, and he says, listen, I can give you life right now, the life of the future I can give you right now. I can give you the life that you'll enjoy forever, like right now. And he says, do you believe this? I said this before here. I'm so glad that he didn't say, do you understand this? I don't understand it. He didn't ask me to understand it. He asked me to believe it, put my full weight on that. So in a sense, Jesus says, I am the resurrection, but what difference does that make? What does it look like in someone's life that embraces a person that says, I am the resurrection of life? I'm going to use two words, the word life and the word hope. In terms of the word life, when he says, I'm the resurrection and the life, he's saying to you, I can give you life like you've never had it before, deep life, satisfying life, life on a whole different level that fills up all the empty places of your soul. I can give you that kind of life. It'll be like water, living water inside of you. And when you embrace Jesus, what happens is it's like your whole old life dies. Like Jesus died and was buried, your old life is over and done with, and you begin to live a new life at a whole different level with the person of Jesus. I know a lot of people that say, well, I'd be a Christian, but it seems so boring or so restrictive or so confined. Think about this. Think about this. He's at a party, and as the party is winding down, he turns water into wine so the party can keep going. That doesn't sound like a boring God to me. I mean, you turn water into wine to keep the party going. This is somebody I should check out. This is the kind of life that he says, I can give you life. Like, you've never seen anything like this. And then hope. Hope that's staggering in its dimensions. Hope of life now, but that goes right through what we would call clinical death. And Jesus says this. He says, if you live and believe in me, you won't die. That means that my mom and my dad and my friends are as fully alive today in heaven and more so than when they were here, fully alive. I mean, do you remember that time when, you do? I do too. When Jesus was, he was confronted by these Pharisees and Sadducees, and the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection, and they talked about Abraham and David and all these guys being dead, and Jesus, whoa. He's not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. You know what he was saying? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, they're alive. The Sadducees didn't believe that. That's why they were sad, you see. But anyway, that's just... You guys have used that before. It's okay. But hope. And here's another bit to the hope, staggering as I mentioned. That there's a place there that he's preparing for you, a place, physical real estate place with no mortgage on it. There's a place waiting for you. Cosmic in its dimensions, because it'll embrace the whole universe. This world will be remade the way he always intended it to be. And there'll be tribes and nations and cultures and languages, but no fear anywhere. No bombs dropped on innocent people. No people without water and food in Gaza or Somalia, like I said, anywhere you go, plenty. Everywhere you go, great joy. It'll be an amazing place. The whole thing remade the way God had it in his heart from the very beginning. And more than that, our friends that have loved the Lord that have gone on will enjoy eternity together with them. This is a huge hope. In fact, I think it's Peter that actually uses this term about it. He calls it a living hope. That's an interesting term, living hope. Why would he call it a living hope? Well, just to separate it from wishful thinking. When I say I hope to lose weight, that's wishful thinking. Living hope is real, substantial, tangible hope. You can take it to the bank, that kind of hope. In other words, this is coming. In a world without hope, it's wonderful to know that I can both life and hope and offer it to anybody that wants it in Jesus. The resurrection of Jesus changed a lot of people, and the person of Jesus is still changing people today. I want you to meet Jo Ellen, one of my friends, who was changed. She'll talk about Alpha. I'll tell you about that at the end, but was changed by encountering Jesus. Just listen to her story for a minute.
I used to come to church, and I was the one that was sitting down during worship, right? I was the one sitting down in worship, and everybody else was singing. I thought everybody was so crazy. I came to church to support my family. My family encouraged me to come to Alpha, and I actually declined quite a few invitations because I thought this was not for me. Listening to Pastor Dan speak about saving whole families was actually like the whole service was curated to me. So I thought, all right, I took home a Bible that day, and it was just like, all right, I'm going to jump in with two feet and give this Alpha a shot. It wasn't for that comfortable, safe environment to ask those questions. I don't know if I would have opened my heart to really have the Holy Spirit pour into me, because now I've got this joy that I have never had before. And my way of thinking is completely different. I used to think that there was something wrong with me. And now I know that I've never been more welcome and more accepted than with Jesus. If there's other people that have someone in their life asking why Jesus, to be able to provide that safe place for them to come ask those questions is life-changing. Jesus has really been such a big impact in my life, I tell you. It's like 180'd and then some, so it's great.
You know, that would be good if she was more excited, but you know, Joellen was completely changed by Jesus, but I could tell you her whole family was. Like her husband, kids, everybody. Like when they got married, it was a bit of a train wreck, actually. You know, they're so in love with Jesus, they want to redo their marriage vows and put them on the foundation of Jesus. It's amazing the transformation that's taking place in her life. And it can happen to you. The great thing about Jesus Christ is he has no favorites. The Bible says, whoever calls on his name will be saved. Full stop. Whoever. You know, it becomes yours. Maybe Romans 8 or Romans 10 verse 9 is probably the verse that is so key to the whole thing. It says this. This is how you engage personally with Jesus. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, you know what that means? That means I am now going to say Jesus is Lord, and I'm not. I'm now going to put the ownership and control of my life into the hands of Jesus Christ. I lay at his feet my money, my relationships, my career, my sexuality, my everything. I lay at his feet. And he now gets to call all the shots. That's what it means when you say Jesus is Lord. It means change, for sure. And then if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that's what makes a person Christian, follower of Jesus. Somebody that says Jesus is Lord, and I believe that God raised him from the dead. It's that simple and that profound. You know, maybe you've never done that. If you're at the point where you actually believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, then could I encourage you to do this before you leave here today? At the end, there'll be people up here with lanyards on. You just walk up to one of them and say, you know, today I just want to tell you that Jesus is Lord of my life. They'll celebrate with you. They'll pray with you. And they'll encourage you to take the next steps. That'd be a great way to do it. Let me end by saying this, that many years ago in China, there was a great earthquake. And this earthquake dislodged a giant stone, a huge boulder from a mountain, and exposed a great cache of wonderful artifacts from 1,000 years ago. When I heard about that, I thought, you know, for those people, a new world suddenly came to light. When the stone was rolled away from the tomb of Jesus and the earth shook, we got our first glimpse of a whole new world, a world where death doesn't have the last word. A world where injustices are made right and innocent suffering is no more and everything sad becomes untrue. A world where everything has changed. He could open up a whole new world for you today simply by you saying, Jesus Christ, be my Savior, be my Lord. I believe that God raised you from the dead. It'll change your life forever. Let's stand together and pray, and the worship team will come back out. We'll worship. Father, we just want to take a moment and thank you again that we're here today with hope, because if you hadn't sent your son, and if you sent him and didn't send your Holy Spirit to tell us what he did, our lives would either be a huge train wreck or we'd be dead without hope. But thank you, Father, that you forgave us all of our sins and you call us your children. You give us a new identity and you bring us into your family and you give us hope that lasts forever. We give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, thank you for joining us for worship today, and you don't have to rush out. As I said, there's homemade cookies in the foyer. As is clear to all, I've tried them, and they're really good. And if you're in the chapel, when I say amen, make a run for it. Make a run for it. It'll be worth your while. But I also want to say this, that starting up this month in April, there is a new Alpha course. Alpha is for people that want to explore Christianity. Maybe you've made your initial commitment to Christ and you just want to get a good foundation under you. But you would be welcome to come. And on April the 16th at 6:30 in our cafe, there's a come and see dinner. Dinner's on us. Just come and check it out. We'll tell you about Alpha, what happens. And if you're interested, we'll get you signed up in a group. But it could be a great decision. So you're welcome to come on April 16th at 6:30 for a come and see dinner. Let me pray, and then we'll worship here for a bit, and we'll have good fellowship in the foyer. Father, again today, we bless you and thank you for your son, Jesus. And I pray as we leave this place that you'd please bless us today and keep us, that you'd make your face shine upon us and be gracious to us, that once more you would turn toward us and give us your peace. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are. like you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.